It's great to speak here. To be honest, I'm super nervous compared to that. I give a talk at Harvard twice, but nice nervous giving a talk at home at IAS. All right, so this topic is about 4D YAML gauge series with the SU2 gauge group precisely. And we will see that it can be viewed as certain boundary conditions for five-dimensional topological quantum field theory, and with a time reversal symmetry that I will explain. And this work is done under the collaboration with two brilliant great students. One is Zhe Yan Wang. She is from China. To be honest, I never really met her before, but we collaborate several works. And Yunqing Zheng is a grad student here at Princeton, and many of you know. And there are some discussion with Robert Gum on something related to four-manifold, five-manifold surgery. So there may be some upcoming work, but I won't present that. Okay, so some of you may not even know me. So JW is my initial, but what's my name and how do you remember me? And what does JW stand for? Just wondering, and to be honest, it's job wanted. I'm in the job wanted status. Okay, so that's my introduction. So just in case that, you know, I'm using some language, and I apologize, but I may not be fluent in any of them, but I'll try to convey to some ideas that in this field of condensed matter theory and also high energy theory and also mathematics. And I feel like I may be confused some people, so I want to make up that you come here. At least you see something you understand. So there are three circles there. It's like three languages. You'll be kind of and the three language when you try to speak at the same time is very hard. But you can try to do it and switch between them. So this will be the convex way of doing this, concave way. And also, so if you speak several languages, like doing these type of things. But anyway, you see something at least, you come here and then there's a reward for this, you come here at least. So, but the reason I show this figure is that if you stay long enough till the very end of my talk, you will see these three circles somehow show up in the YAML gauge theory somehow. And the way to obtain something similar, actually, this configuration that I will show is actually thinking about YAML theory living on some boundary as a boundary condition for some topological quantum field theory in five dimensions. And there will be, later on, there will be introduced some surface operators and then membrane operators. Surface operator, in this case, will be two dimensions in the RAID spheres. And then there's surface operator in two dimension, two sphere, and also there's a membrane operator in blue, in three manifold. So this configuration, I'm trying to decompose a five dimensional sphere in terms of gluing a D3 disk times S2, D3 disk times S2, and glue with S2 times D3. So some people may have a good way to visualize this. But the point here is that D3 times S2 and S2 times D3, they have this shared boundary, S2 times S2. When you glue this S2 times S2 together, you can make a five sphere. I'm trying to decompose a five sphere into two sets. And then I insert some surface, two surface and membrane inside. And I want to show that later, if you stay long enough till the very end, you will see this configuration show up again, such that if you design some excitations from TQFT such that those excitations are created by the membrane or surface operator, then if you design the space-time trajectory looks like this, then there'll be some statistics show up. And this will be a link invariant in this theory. And then if you stay long enough, you will see that how do I see the non-trivial linking by filling the surfaces to a one high dimensional cipher hypervolume, and there will be an intersecting number. Counting this intersecting number is related to the linking number. And so if you want to see the result, then you should stay till very end. Okay, so this talk will based on both slides and Blebo. And the major work I'll present is the first one, 1904. But there are a sequence of work I was thinking related topics. But it cannot be overly emphasized the important work by Natti Seiberg, and which has a large inspiration on for me to think about related things. And even if I don't digest the whole paper, I still feel like I can do something. So you can see the importance of these two works. And I will try to address some possible more complete way to describe so-called the Tohu anomalies of a global symmetry associated to the SUN Yang-Mills gauge theory in four dimension. And in this case, I'm not consider any supersymmetry, and also without coupling to any matter fields. In condensed matter language, this will be emergent matter field. Okay, and I will particularly focus on the term with the theta term in high energy theory. And the theta term will be equivalent to the second chain clause that will mention later. Okay, so there is such a term being dynamical and also a Yang-Mills term. Okay, is there any question? You can interrupt me anytime. And I'll use, as I said, use some intuitions in condensed matter, and I also try to think deeply in the UV as lattice regularization, and I also switch to quantum field theory and use some math. And the tool I use majorly is topology in math. There will be some slight use of a cobordism group and group cohomology, and there will be some thing related to geometry topology of link invariant and surgery and some, yeah, so, and also manifold reduction. So this will be related to algebraic topology, geometric topology. And to fix my terminology, when I refer to m d, little d, will be meaning the space-time dimension. If I say m plus one big D means space plus time dimensions. So this will be compensating between the two community. Okay, so motivations. First of all, why do we study pure Nansouci Yang-Mills? Is that in condensed matter, there are a lot of emergent gauge theory, and we call quantum spin liquids, or precisely iso spin liquids. So there are some flavor or symmetry, and there are some emergent gauge fields. And those are quantum bosonic liquids, but one can also consider quantum fermionic liquids. At low energy, there are a lot of different type of vacua. There are a lot of quantum field theory. And there are people study the U1 case, U1 quantum spin liquids. So this will be an example for SU2 quantum spin liquids. In high energy theory, we say that we are made of a quasi-particle of QCD and plus electrons. And it will be important to emphasize that 2% of our mass is from Higgs, but most of our mass actually is from the QCD condensate. So it's also good to understand better what's going on. And for astro people, they like to study neutral star. And for mass problem, I think Edward knows more than anyone else how to pose a problem. I think there is a Yang-Mills mass gap problem to prove the compact simple gauge group G. There's a non-trivial quantum Yang-Mills can be defined and exists on alpha with a mass gap. So the system now look like today, motivated by some condensed matter setup will be some 4D Yang-Mills. As I say, a setup equal pi. And there are some anomalous feature here. Precisely states that in order to realize the necessary global symmetry, which I will say is a time reversal symmetry and one form center global symmetry, I must put this on the boundary of some in a local way. To realize the symmetry in a local way, I must to realize this on the boundary of some five-dimensional invertible TQFT. Okay, so invertible TQFT means that a certain kind of topological quantum field theory, when you try to compute the partition functions on a closed manifold, the absolute value will be equal to one. So the most thing you can get is some complex phases. And you can think invertible in the condensed matter sense is that there is always an inverted phases. You can combine the two to get to the trivial vacua. So I will try to make connection such that Yang-Mills theory will live on a boundary of such a certain inverted TQFT. So I want to determine how exactly or precisely what's this TQFT. And in condensed matter language, some of them you may familiar is that these are called symmetry protected topological states. So these phases exist when we demand the global symmetry And if the Gomov symmetry is demand, then you cannot deform this state by a local unitary transformations. Again, local unitary transformation to a trivial vacua. So there is a sharp distinction between the vacua of SPT and a trivial gap insulator if the symmetry needs to be preserved. So in other words, there must be a phase transitions between SPT to trivial vacua. Or you must go through a path that the symmetry is broken. So these are the statements. So these days in quantum many body system is also known as a short range entangled states. So I will try to specify these 5D states, which protect by time reversal and one phone Z2 center symmetry. Okay, so these are motivations. So I want to outline what kind of system I look at, just in case some people might leave earlier. Okay. And one can try to write some, think about this in a more general manifold. So we're actually thinking about the Young Mills as some boundary conditional, some five dimensional theory. And then you can put this on a five manifold with a boundary. So the 4D Young Mills live on the boundary, while this 4D Young Mills live on the boundary, while 5D invertible TQFT is in this bulk. Okay. And you will see later that this invertible TQFT actually is a Mar2 class, which means if I have two of them, it's actually equivalent to a trivial theory. So if I think about condensed matter waves, like if I stack two of them, I can include local interactions between the system such that these states can be deformed to a trivial states, a trivial vacuum, or trivial product states. And then later on, I will do an intermediate step to gauge the one phone center global symmetry of a whole system, including the boundary of SU2 Young Mills and also the 5D invertible TQFT, such that you will perform a transformation that from the bulk short range entangled state to a new state, which is long range entangled states, shown in next slides. And also the boundary theory will change from SU2 theoretical pi Young Mills to SO3 theoretical pi Young Mills. So these coordinates are just illustration for contest map people if they cannot think higher dimensional space. So then the system two, after gauging one more symmetry, as I say, which will determine in the talk is that there is a topological quantum field theory, which is not invertible anymore, and which is more familiar, for example, to people who study Trans-Simon theory in three dimensions. But here we have a five-dimensional topological quantum field theory. And in addition, the time reversal symmetry is still preserved in the bulk. So actually, these are known as symmetry, time reversal symmetry enriched topological states. And there's also long-range entanglement, such that you cannot deform this state to a trivial product states, even if you break any symmetry. So these are different statements from the short-range entangled state. Short-range entangled state can be deformed to trivial product state by breaking global symmetries completely. But this one, even if you break time reversal, this is still distinct states from trivial vacua. These are a TQFT. Okay, so the system will have a time reversal. And once you gauge one phone global symmetry, there's a two phone gauge field. So these are the system. Any question? So again, you can think about a more general kind of a setup. There are some five manifold. You put this long range entangled TQFT, also called symmetry enriched states in the bulk, while there is a boundary condition, this SO3 zero pi. Okay. But our comment later is that SU2 zero pi actually is time reversal symmetric, but SO3 zero pi Young Mills actually time reversal is broken. So this will be a time reversal broken boundary conditions, while the bulk I can keep time reversal. Okay. All right, so let's briefly warm up about the higher global symmetries. So the work, mainly of this line of thinking is developed by Cyber and colleagues. So as you are familiar about the ordinary zero phone global symmetry, there is a Norden theorem for the classical symmetry. And if there is a continuous symmetry, there should be a conserved current. For example, translation symmetry, there is a momentum conservation. Time translation symmetry has energy momentum, energy conservations. But this notion can be generalized to extend objects and also to the quantum sense. So you should view those things as some kind of operator in the quantum theory. So I will give some example just to warm up. So the charged objects in the global symmetry is known as the, for example, let me see. So let's because I'm trying to give some idea for condensed matter people. So not sure whether there's any. Is that let's start from zero phone global symmetry, U1 global symmetry. The familiar example is the insulator phase that has a, let's say, zero phone U1 global symmetry. While the super Fourier phase actually has a U1 zero phone global symmetry spontaneous broken. So important thing about the zero phone global symmetry here is that you should find out the charge objects and the operator. In the system of an insulator, okay, so maybe I need to turn on the light. The other guy. So the first system, let's say the U1 zero phone symmetry, the charge object can be a bosonic operator, let's say B or B dagger. While this will be a zero dimensional operator that you can put on somewhere in the space time or in the space, in the Hamiltonian picture or in the path integral picture. And there's also a charge operator that measures the symmetry. And as I say, there's a U1 symmetry, so there should be associated a symmetry generator. In this case, this will be EI theta and the number operator. The number operator is related to creating boson, aligning boson rate, and creating bosons. And for some of the condensed matter colleague, you are familiar with the phases described insulator to super Fourier transitions, where the insulator phase has a U1 symmetry preserving zero phone, and super Fourier has the U1 spontaneous symmetry breaking. So the way to describe this quantum theory is that writing the boson operator in terms of phi modes, where phi is treated as operators, you may need to normalize it related to the local number. But let me just skip that. And you will see that this phi modes and the number operator actually do not commute. Let's see, IH bar, let's see. If I put this on the space lattice, then I can put spatial coordinates, I and j. And then you can, some of you might be familiar with this. If you write a lattice model with boson hopping terms and with some interaction terms, you'll find out this anti-commutation relation between the U1 mode and number mode, the anti-commutation relation specify two phases. When the number is well-defined and when the symmetry is preserved, this goes to an insulator phase. While when the phi is localized, condensed, a boson operator condensed, then the phi is fixed, the slow fluctuating modes will become the super Fourier modes or ghost dome modes. And these are determined by the quantum fluctuation between these two operators. So similarly, we can go to the one phone U1 symmetry. Example can be a U1 gauge theory. So these are the examples. And you have the one phone gauge field A. Let's write the field stress dA, which star dA. So you will see the similar equation of motion that govern the commutation relation is the A and star dA operators. And for U1 gauge theory, there is a one phone U1E symmetry. And then depends on the dimensional space time. If it's general D dimension, there's a D minus two phone, oh sorry, D minus three phone U1 magnetic symmetry. I should leave up a bit. So the charge objects in this case will be EI. A, the Wilson line for the one phone electric symmetry, measured by the electric surface operator. So let me just write it as UE. So these are WE. DA. And then this is theta. And for the one form or D minus three form magnetic symmetry to Hund line is the charge objects. And I should dualize the A to the V field by the relation dA star dV. And I can write magnetic symmetry generator. So the point here is that I just try to work through this concept in the sense that I personally believe this concept also worked universally for condensed matter setup, even for a latest version of the description of generalized global symmetry. And we can keep going to illustrate the other cases. Let me just show on the slides. So if I have, I mentioned the charge object and charge operator. So another thing I would like to stress and mention in my talk is basically the SU2 gauge theory. So in that case, for SU2 gauge theory, we have a one-form Z2 electric symmetry. And that symmetry is measured by the, that symmetry has a charge objects of the Wilson line. And for the Wilson line fundamental representation, there's a non-trivial one-form Z2 electric symmetry. So the expression is similar, except that I should write a trace over this pace ordering and trace for this Wilson line. And there's a corresponding electric surface operator. And for the SO3 gauge theory, one need to gauge the one-form Z2 electric symmetry. One can gauge one-form Z2 electric symmetry for SU2 gauge theory to obtain the SO3 gauge theory. And the process can be think of as following. When you gauge the one-form Z2 electric symmetry, the charge object is not gauge invariant anymore. So it's a gauge invariant object. And on the other hand, when you gauge, you can think about the charge currents, the charge operator, the symmetry generator, coupled to the field that as a background field, you can when you dynamical gauge, you make it dynamical. When you dynamical gauge, you make this as a variable that you somewhere in path integral. In that case, you will see that the charge operator condensed. So the charge operator for the theory condensed the boundary of this the boundary of this operator. The operator living on the boundary of this charge operator become genuine operator, which means that the operator that has no the operator does not require living on the boundary of some higher dimension objects. So let me illustrate for the U1 gauge theory case. If I look at the U1 gauge theory with one-form electric symmetry, the Wilson line is this EIA, while the magnetic surface operator is this star dV, which is EIDA. And generally, the theta is a U1 parameters. But if I gauge the one-form U1 asymmetry, you will see first that the dA has a boundary of a Wilson line. And then you see that the UE, the electric surface operator, has a boundary of the Tahoe line. And when I couple the, let's say when I couple the, when I gauge the one-form U1E electric symmetry, I couple the background field to the symmetry generator. Let's say if I gauge one-form U1E, then I couple the lambda here. This. Just a second. This one to the symmetry generator. Then you see that the dV disappear, while the V living on the boundary become manifest in the spectrum. So the Tahoe line appears. And for the U1 case, certainly the two symmetry occurs. For the SU2 case, actually, I only have the fundamental Wilson lines. When I gauge the one-form Z2E, the boundary of this UE surface operator will make the Tahoe operators manifest in the SU2 theory. So the main message here is just say that the SU2 theory has one from Z2E, and SO3 has one from Z2M. You can transform one to the other by gauging the one from Z2 symmetry. And the way to see this is that just writing down the charge object and charge operator, and then look at the relations between the boundary of the symmetry generator. If this has an open surface, then what will be the correspondence boundary operators? Okay, so because the things I want to mention is more than just the one-form symmetry, I also need time reversal, so I should discuss the time reversal symmetry here. So the time reversal symmetry is a discrete symmetry, and it actually only occurs at C equals 0 and pi. So in this case, if I write the Yamiot theory with this Yamiot term and the theta term, then the one-form gauge field transform in this way on the time reversal, where the temporal component does not flip this flip sign, while the space-time coordinate flip only for the time t component, and f wedge f will flip sign. You mean time reversal? Right.
But there's no, for an automorphism, there's no automorphism that changes the sign value, which is what you need to do. So for U1, you would be right, but I don't think
okay.
That would be very true for SU2.
Okay, let me be right. So I think the consequence I need is this one. F wedge F will be minus F wedge. Yeah. So then maybe I'm just thinking about U1 case. Let's flip it. Yeah, let's not talk about this one. Just F wedge F go to minus. Oh, sorry, this one has no square then. Sorry. Yeah, this is a typo. I'm sorry about this. Okay, good. Okay. Right. Sorry about this. Yeah, there's no square. I just write F square or F wedge star F. Okay, so the main point here is that on the time reversal, F wedge F will go to minus F wedge F. I think here Ed was right. Probably I'm just writing the U1 case. I was not careful about this. Okay, so the theta term with 2 pi periodicity makes the theta equal to pi, equal to minus pi will be time reversal invariant. And there's also one from Z2 symmetry which shifts the gauge field globally with flat connections. So if I write Wilson line operator, it's also invariant under the electric, so I didn't write the SU1, SU2 case, but then one can write it. So it will make it will shift A by flat connections. So the thing is that if I have one from Z2 symmetry, I can hold a two from field. So this will transform the B field as well. So this will be impotent. And the main thing here, oh, sorry. I think this one is, the main thing here I want to compare is that the I will show later on the blackboard is that the derivation we have is slightly different actually from the derivation of a cyber et al. So these are the generalized global symmetry paper, but the derivation I'll compare is the other one, the paper in 1703. The title is theta time reversal and temperature. Okay, so let me summarize how I got there to get a result. How do I determine the theory? So in a sense, I want to lead you to a result that the main result, whatever way one start to do the calculations, I want to stay guide you to the result that how to determine the phi d TQFT, inverted TQFT. So these are the goal. But then the setup is the following. In our case, we couple the Yamiot theory to two-form Begon gauge field. There's a one-form Z2 symmetry. And eventually, the two-form Begon gauge field will be related to a cohomology class of a B field, which is a Z2 class. And right. So I think as a physicist, a lot of us, including colleagues like Zoha, Nati et al., we basically try to understand the coupling of a U1 field stress to the two-form field or this B field in this second cohomology class in this manner. I want to stress that there could be additional detail subtlety when you want to do it rigorously mathematically. But I think this won't affect the outcome. So the situation is that, first of all, we are in the SU2 gauge field space, SU2 gauge theory with the SU2 gauge field space F. But we want to promote this SU2 to the U2. So there's an additional abelian sectors. I think I have a space over here. So the idea is that when I turn on the background field, the way to view this is that originally I'm in the SU2 connections. But I want to turn on background field such that I should do the theory in SO3. And the relation I will use is that U2 mod U1 is the same as SU2 times Z2 mod U1 and then mod U1. Times U1 mod Z2, and which is SU2 mod Z2, is SO3. So we introduce additional U1 sectors, and then we want to couple the theory to this additional U1, and then we can view the theory in the SO3. So the thing is that if you consider the SU2 theory, there are some open pages of the SU2 fibers. And then the connection is basically the transition function between this open charts. And there's consistent conditions about this transition functions. When you have three overlapping pages for SU2 theory, this must be locally trivial. If I view this theory in SO3 gauge theory, then I'm allowed to turn on the non-trivial B field such that the SU2 part, even though if the transition functions, these overlapping pages, there's three functions, let's say gij, transition function, gjk, and gki, they are non-trivial in the center of SU2, but still trivial in the trivial in SO3. So this non-trivial part is related to the turn on the background B field. And this setup basically is the statement here, is that we have the non-trivial constraint such that the turn on the B field will change the U2 field stress. So these are the normal statement that when I try to view that in the SU2 gauge theory with a non-trivial two-form background, actually I can leave to SO3 and then with this condition constraint. However, in my case, I would like to decorate the theory by additional terms related to the space-time tangent bundle. So these data, W1 and W2, are Stifel-Whitney classes. It's related to the local data of the tangent bundle of the manifold M. T stands for the tangent bundle for manifold M. So these K1, K2 are Mach 2 coefficients, which can be 0 or 1. So with these conditions, these are more than the usual case people consider when K1, K2 is 0. And we want to understand the consequence of turning on this, and how does this affect understanding this theory when I turn on the B field, and also when I have a time reversal symmetry. And there will be detailed calculations one need related work of Steenross on higher cup product, but I will just use implicitly in the talk. Okay, so how is that the different type of K1, K2 here related to the more formal setup in mass, or maybe more down-to-earth setup in condensed matter, is the following. So it turns out that what we are doing is that there is a space-time manifold OD with the OD structures, and we also want to have the gauge bundle SU2. So the whole space-time manifold together with the gauge bundle, I should view as some enlarged G prime structure of the manifold. It turns out that this can be classified by some calculations related to this group. From the space-time BOD, you can think about this as a time reversal and also some Euclidean version of rotational symmetry, but also discrete time reversal. If you think about Lorentz, these are the Euclidean version. And then there's a Z2 extensions related to the center of SU2. This extension is classified in the work of Free and Hopkins. It turns out that the non-trivial extension is ready to turning on W1 TM squared, W2 TM for the space-time OD, space-time tangent bound of OD, and then also compensate the SU2 gauge bundle, the SO3 bundle actually, when I turn on the B field. So that's basically, I'm trying to relate this statement to the earlier one. So these are the terms that classify like extensions, and these are the terms related to turning on the SO3, non trivial background and associated to the SO3 gauge bundle.
What is ELD?
ELD is a very good question. It's a very strange group. The order is OD times Z2, and this has a two pair of data. OD, actually I don't have a physical understanding of this group, but it's OD and another group of Z4, finite group of Z4, such that the determinant of OD, these are pair of data, determine the ED group, and determine OD will relate to the J square. Yeah, these are formal things. But it turns out that the OD is related to the extension by W1 TM square. And the O is actually has no, just related to the earlier case, the gauge bundle is trivial.
What means have an ELD structure?
Yeah.
Is that the orientation bundle
right.
Structure
right.
Is
right. Okay. All right. Thanks for the comment. And for the case of the other two cases, that when I also turn on the W2 TM, which related to the spin structures, is that there's additional two class. And these two class are studied in condensed matter. One of them is related to the topological superconductor, which people call a C1 class in the Kaden-Zumbauer notations. And then there's another C2 class related to this symmetry group. And in the more down-to-earth languages, that the pin plus actually require the fermions become a Kramers doubly, which means under time reversal, T squared will be -1, while the X on the fermions. So there's a doublet. And while P minus is T squared +1, so it's a singlet under time reversal. And so these are the 4D data that relates the space-time tangent bundle of OD and the gauge bundle of SO3. Well, one thing is that the phi d theory we study actually has a time reversal symmetry. And how is that related to these formal data with SU2? Is that this hasn't been done, but let me just state. I think when you gauge the SU2 theory, Yang Miao's terms, with these terms as a topological insulator superconductor, as a topological terms, and summing over all the gauge bundle, then the theory has emerged on Wan Feng Z2 symmetry and also have time reversal. It turns out that the theory will have a Tahu anomalies in 4D. It should be viewed as the boundary of some topological term from this group. And if you, some of you may be in the audience when Pavel Putra gave a talk about work maybe 1 year ago or something, it's actually related to a sum of this group when we try to state some result by coupling Yang Miao's term to these topological terms. Okay. So then these are the four class. But what exactly is those Z2, Ma2 class of this TQFT? It turns out that one can compute the Poisson group for this. And they are actually four generators. So these are formal data. But as you know, B already introduced is a Z2, Z2 class, or Z2 Tuchel cycle, B. And there is a more formal data called SQ1, which is a Steenrod square. But this data, to me, I cannot just read the abstract data. I want to understand how exactly it can be written this on the lattice. This data actually can be written on the lattice by thinking about SQ1B maps B in H2, a two-co cycle, to H3, a three-co cycle in Z2. And the formal way to write data is that SQ1B is just one half of delta B. So what I mean is that those data can be locally written on a five-dimensional manifold in the local data as a phi simplex. Well, I should write a five-dimensional simplex. Let me draw. So these are two simplex, three simplex, and then one more lattice, four simplex, and then have one more, five simplex. And I should connect to every point. So there's a 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. While the B, SQ1B, is ratio data of a B, let's say 0, 1, 2, assign two simplex as a B field on the two simplex. And then SQ1 will be a cup of 1 half delta B. Well, delta B can be assigned on 2, 3, 4, 5. And delta means a coboundary operator, such that you pave the 2, 3, 4, 5, which is the three simplex, with full boundary of two simplex. And then you just do this summation and subtraction, depends on the orientation. So there are four terms like this. And 2, 3, 4, 3, 4, 5, 2, 3, 5, 2, 4, 5. So these data actually can be written on lattice. And the good thing is that then computer can do it. So this formal data actually has a very precise meaning. So you shouldn't be scared, even if you've seen just right now. A second data is Q2 as Q1B will be written behind the label. But I can write it. Let me see. Let me just leave up this. It's OK. Let's see. Okay, so let me see. Do I have it? Actually, yeah, let me write it here. Because there's a SQ2 SQ1B also can be written on the lattice. And I think I do have it. It's here. Do I have it? Yeah, it's here. So this data is the okay, I have a 1 half here as well. The SQ2 SQ1B is again map B SQ1B map H2 to H3 in Z2 coefficient, and SQ2 of SQ1B map H3 to H5 with Z2 coefficient. And then for B is a cocycle, you can write this in terms of higher cup product. And the notion of higher cup product is just that I try to put these things on a simplex. Well, there is a shared age, and those things will make the three simplex term and three simplex term cup one become a five simplex terms. So this can be written as a five cocycle, basically. So this explains the data. Okay, so let me go down. Okay, but these terms are getting formal. So in the end, you want to know what exactly is this TQFT. So I'm just trying to well define this. So you will see that the data really defines some theory. It's a Bode's invariant, so it's a TQFT. All right, so then I explain two of the data. So this will be used actually later. You will see that actually the work by Nati Cyber and Zohar, actually the term they determine is related to a summation of these two terms. And go ahead. Right.
The anomaly should be linear?
Yeah, linear to time reversal. And then quadratic to B.
Right.
So it's TBB term.
Right.
Yeah. So it's basically layered, which I will explain then. Yeah, let me see. Right. TM, yeah. Right, which always one? So to back up what exactly is the statement, is that in the CR time reversal temperature 1703 of the paper by Nati and Zohar et al., they write down a linear T-dependent anomaly and also quadratic to the B field. So these are the terms. And I claim that this will be precisely the addition of these two terms. So one should be able to massage these two terms addition together such that we're proportional to that. It turns out the answer is yes, is that that term, additional these two terms will ratio W1 Stifel-Winning class, first Stifel-Winning class, W1 TM and PB. But there's a twist way precisely to define W1 TM. It's proportional to W1 TM in some way, but not exactly. And there's one half coefficient. I can't write this on the blip. That's a subtle part, is that because PPE, when you, it's not exactly W1TM, it's actually a Z-fold coefficient W1TM. I don't have a very physical understanding, but I check some math reference. It turns out there is such a term really defined. And so I think for our purpose, it's just that it's proportional to T and then quadratic to the B field, to, yeah, quadratic dependent to the B field. So, yeah. And to answer Edward's question is that when PB coupled with this term, it turns out this will be an even coefficient in Z4, while one can define this in Z2 by taking 1/2. But these are also formal beyond me. I just learned this statement from reading some past paper. But the good thing is that these two terms indeed produce the dependence what the Nati had. But these two terms are not mentioned. Well, I should mention the fourth term is related to the recent work we did with Edward on this new SU2 anomaly has this, this term, but it doesn't appear in the SU2 Yamil theory we discussed today. However, the third term actually occur in the theory I will mention, which is W1TM squared SQ1B. But in a closed five manifold, I can replace this term to qubit T dependent W1TM and B term. And just to back up to Huang, because he came in a bit late, is that the B field is actually a two-cocycle with a Z2 coefficient. It's like a B field. If you think differential forms like Z2 field, but it's actually a Z2 class two-cocycle. All right. And then this term also can be written as probably have a bit more familiar data as related to third Stiefel-Winnie class plus W1QB. So the linear combination of these two can get W3B. But this only works when the manifold is closed. We need to require to use some formula called Wu formula when the manifold is closed. Okay.
Do you have any idea how to detect the second
and third? So then I want to, the next slide, yeah. So I want to say what exactly is this data mean? Is that how do we read from maybe from condensed language that if you think about this SU2 gauge theory, we don't have a massless, so low mass emergent matter field, but in condensed matter, they like to think in a deep UV. There are some way to couple the Wilson line to very massive, highly massive objects. And those things actually will explicitly break higher form symmetry at deep UV, but higher symmetry will emerge at IR. While if I have a way to access those data at a deep UV, then I will claim that the Wilson line coupled to those deep UV matter field in a way that they are either bosonic or Kremers or fermionic or Kremers singly or Kremers doublet. So these are four version of the possibility of coupling to the deep UV data, and this will precisely correspond to the full theory I mentioned. So 1, 2, 3, 4 correspond to early 1, 2, 3, 4. And the summary is that when it's bosonic and singlet, it's the most familiar term that the TDB paper, the Zohar's work and Nati's work, 1703 papers. And if I have a change in the Kremers doublet, singlet to doublet, actually I get one more term, which is the WQB term, if the manifold is finitely closed, so there's subtlety. Okay, if actually the theory is fermionic and singly, actually I get the same term, W1QB. These are the PIM minus case. But there's a one term which I was going to comment is that this term is like SQ1 or 1/2 of a co-boundary delta term on the W2B term, the four dimensional term. This term actually doesn't play a role if the manifold in phi d is closed. But if the phi manifold has a boundary, which we need, because our Yamil live on the boundary of 4D term, then that term plays some role. It turns out that this term still has a non-trivial contribution to cancel the anomaly inflow or matching between the 4D and 5D theory. And stare this a bit more close is that we write some term in five dimensions, but you cannot read anything from five dimension. You cannot detect this on a five closed manifold. Only when you have full manifold on a boundary, you can detect this. So this reminds me something like Weiss-Rumino-Witten type of terms, in the sense that I write some terms in, want to write something in 2D, but I want to access one higher dimensional 3D in order to write a term. But the difference is that this term is not a Z class. It's actually more like a Z4 class. The reason is that when I have a two of these terms, this contribute 4D boundary as a SPT. But if I have two of these terms, you can contribute a 4D terms, which is a Bohdian invariant in four dimensions, or 4D SPD terms. But if I have four terms, it becomes trivial. So these are discrete class. And also, there's also a case where Cramer's doubly fermionic also give the different type of anomaly. In any case, all the anomaly for those SU2 Yang-Mills with CR term all have this dependent, the TPV dependence terms. But there's additional terms. And sorry, the statement I make earlier is this one, is that there's a strange term. It looks like a phi D trivial term. It's not even a Bohdian invariant. It's trivial, doesn't contribute if a manifold is closed. Sorry, yeah, this line is wrong. You got this line. Just look, there's a delta here. There's a delta, one half delta. But there's a non-trivial fractional term if you try to write in four dimensions. At this moment, I don't have a better understanding than the statement make here. But I know that when the phi manifold is closed, it doesn't have any effects. But when the manifold has a boundary, which we require when we put a 4D Yang-Mills on the boundary, then there are some effects like this. And I'm very positive at this moment. OK, so because I want to have a 4D and 5D theory coupled together, so I should write some partition function, incorporate the two terms. And in the next, I will going to show the derivation on the black box. Is that the theory we have, other than the Yang-Mills term, there is also a terms that I earlier write associated to FHF. But right now, we want to define the way we probe the theory is that we want to define this theory on an unorientable manifold in four dimensions to probe the time reversal anomaly. So before I go to putting the theory on a non-orientable manifold, let's take one step back and recall what the TTT paper in 1703 by Nati et al. They did. Actually, they didn't put on a non-orientable manifold or unorientable manifold. They can just do this on the orientable manifold by couple the theory to the B field, two form B field, and then do the time reversal transformations. And they see that they get additional terms, which they want to check whether these are the 4D, can be averted by 4D counter terms. In condensed matter language, what this is trying to do is that couple the theory to background field, and then see under the transformation, do you gain some fractional terms of SPT, which is not SPT by four dimension itself. If that's the case, then it indicates a possible anomaly. And that procedure of doing that by the Nati and O actually can also access the anomaly for time reversal anomaly, even on orientable manifold. But they could miss additional terms. So here we are trying to put the theory on unorientable manifold. So we should be aware for those terms we write cannot define put on full manifold, we cannot define more than a Mach 2 class. Because when we try to write down the volume form for this, we need to determine the orientations to write the volume form. But right now, we want to define an unorientable manifold. The only way we can do is just try to take a Mach 2 class. It turns out that in order to write like data, many of the terms start from the 4D theory cannot make sense in four dimension itself. So we want to extend those undefinable terms to five dimensions. And that way, we find those terms start from the Chern class C1 and C2. It will be written as this kind of form. So C1 looks like relates to the four-dimensional theory. However, remember, we have a gauge bundle constraint. The way we probe the theory is that the C1 actually now on an unorientable manifold is also a Mach 2. We take a Chern class also in the Mach 2, and then restrict to the other Stifel-Whitney class and the B field also in the Mach 2 relations by this. In that case, we can reinterpret this undefinable term in 4D to a phi D and convert all the data from a gauge theory dependent 4D term to a phi D term that does not depend on C1 Chern class. Okay, so I want to summarize though, and then show the derivation behind the label for you. So the result is that if I reinterpret the phi d term, it turns out that indeed this will be a precise phi d TQFT, inversor TQFT, obey as the Bohdian invariant of the group, preserving time reversal and preserving one form Z2 symmetry, the center symmetry. And there's a K1 dependent term. When you turn on the Wilson line such that it becomes a Cramer's doublet, then there's additional term you gain. And there's also a K2 term, which you gain when you try to decorate theory to become Wilsonite become fermionic. So, but I explain the subtle effect here. This doesn't contribute to five closed manifold, but it has a boundary effect. But I think this result.
So
yeah.
Yes,
depends on which full version of a Yang-Mills, because we have full version. Because the SU2 Wilson line can be fermionic or bosonic, can be Kramer singlet doublet. And there's the latest understanding of this is deep in the UV, when you try to construct this lattice from some a local Hilbert space with local Hamiltonian, you imagine this is deep UV Hamiltonian and flow to an intermediate field theory. And those Wilson line are engineered or the gauge field emerge in the way that all the matter in the UV are coupled. If the matter is coupled to gauge field, is massive matter, is Kramer's singlet doublet, or bosonic fermionic will affect different type version of gauge theory at the intermediate energy level. Okay, all right, so then there's a derivation. So the derivation, let me just leave up and then Don't turn over the screen, it's okay. Yeah, the statement is just that one just need to try to make sense. When I write a 4D terms in this way, coupled to B field, I cannot define more than just Mar 2 class. So I want to make everything just Mar 2. The only term, don't turn off, oh, that's good. There's a C2 terms. Those terms are Mar 2 class, so we cannot define on full manifold. And right now we put full manifold as unrentable, and we take M5 boundary, also unrentable boundaries M4. And it turns out that we can write this, follow the Steenra algebra. It turns out that this term subject to a gauge bundle constraint written here, you can boil it down and then do some massage. It turns out that there is a term precisely related to the Bode-Zeng invariant that I write earlier. And so then that leads to the result that we have a 4D and a 5D couple system where 4D has a Yang-Mills theory, which is strong couple gauge theory. Well, 5D is a short range entangled, nearly trivial vacua, but it's still protected by global symmetry, non-trivially. And these are the theory. And then now I want to end up by rewarding the result by lead you to the Anionic strings and brains. How do I get this? Is that gauge the one form Z2 symmetry and turn on dynamical two form field. In that case, we have this B field in H2. We just sum over all this B field and weight by this SPT amplitude. And if I want to write a Cochin field theory, I need to introduce additional normal two form field and three form field. In a sense, if I have a two-form field B in five dimension, I should write down a dual little B field. And where the cocycle conditions for the B field DB is zero, the closed condition is imposed as a Lagrange multiplier of this two-form B field. While the W1, W2 can also be imposed with this closed relation for the stiffer winning class by introducing a three-form field and the three-form field C and two-form field H. So that's how try to make a theory dynamical. There's additional membrane, three-dimensional objects, and two-dimensional objects. Okay, so let's get back. All right, so I'm nearly done. Okay, so I should also say that when I gauge the one-form Z2 symmetry, the SU2 theory turn to the SO3, and one should consider the periodicity of the SO3 CR term. It turns out that because the instant tone for SO3 Yang-Mills on spin and non-spin are different, and you will change the periodicity of CR term. On spin manifold, the theta is 4 pi because there's a 1/2 instant tone. On the non-spin manifold, the theta is 8 pi periodicity. There's a quarter instant tone for SO3 theory. So time reversal in this case will be explicitly broken on the boundary. And then now we want to just focus on study the 5D gauge theory, which is we call the symmetry enriched TQFT by time reversal. And there are some computations. It turns out that there are a lot of exotic invariants, which I also encounter when I study the T TQRT formulation of a dark Witten theory. But before I go to that, I just want to show how do I view this graph. Let's just recall the usual link between 2S1, let's say. You can take D equal to 3. And then I draw an S1, a red circle here, and draw another S1, the blue circle there. And you can think this feature is like a S1 and S1 link in this way. So I'm trying to decompose a three sphere as D equals 3, right? So D2 times S1, where this are D2, and then times S1, which is related to this circle. And there's also a D2 here, bounded by this S1, times another S1 related to this circle. And then if I try to put the circle bounded these two disks together, I'll see two S1 circles, and they are linked. And to determine the link invariant, the link number is that you can just try to fill the volume of the area of one of the disks, and this will count in an intersecting number. When you do that, actually, because the way I try to draw the figure, it turns out that when I fill one of the disks, this will also have additional line. You can just imagine when I try to draw two of the disks, or the two of a circle, and filling one of the disk, there's additional line here. So this will be the intersecting number. Counting this number will tell you the invariant of the non-trivial configurations detailed by the link invariant. So these are the familiar link invariant that you learn, like BF theory or Harnoy-Bohm braiding. But one of the thing occurring in the Yang-Mills is that there's actually a five-dimensional link associated to, if I have a term like the TBB term, here I just write W1BB. It turns out that introduce W1 field W1 with this flat or closed conditions, I need an additional C field. There's a three-dimensional membrane operator coupled to the W1. And there's also additional little B field coupled to this big B, BDB and CDW1. In that case, the C field and the little B field actually become the extent operators in the five-dimensional theory. And the non-trivial link is the following, is that there's three set of operators. Two of them are two dimensions, which is, for example, an S1 circle spinning, rotating by another S1. And also the another S1 circle spinning by another S1. So they are two pair of torus by drawing this. And this S1 and that S1 is filled inside the four-dimensional disk. Well, there's additional three-dimensional operators from the W1, coupled to W1. And then these three-dimensional spheres are bounded as a boundary of a default bowl. Actually, draw this configuration, you can test. This will have a non-trivial link. And what I mean is that the non-trivial link is valid. When you try to fill the three-dimensional space, two-dimensional, by one high-dimensional cipher volume, and then you just try to fill the volume, try to count how many points it intersects. In this configuration, you will have one. Okay. So I can do the exercise if you want. So there are two S1 circles here. Spinning means rotating by another S1. When I fill the blue disk, they can intersect one point here. Well, I fill the three sphere by a four-dimensional default bowl, and then I fill this volume. It will intersect the same point here. And this point is still non-vanished once I fill this red one. And this extend in this figure here also intersect this point. So these are counting the non-trivial invariant, link invariant. So there's an expression that one can write this derived from a field theory associated to the topological quantum field theory in five dimension. But these are the results. These are the configuration that detects the theory. And there are a lot more, so which I will skip, is that some theory related to so-called triple linking number of three pair of surfaces actually also occur. And that kind of link I also encounter when I study some most exotic type of TQFT in the Dagua-Witten theory. When there's a interacting TQFT in four dimensions, they have this kind of invariant. And I can determine the link intersecting number by, again, doing the trick by filling the one high-dimensional volume. And these are the last one, which I show in the beginning. Thanks for staying for so long, is that when you have a three-pair of three-dimensional surfaces, and then a two-dimensional sphere, let's say, and then put it on the five-dimensional space in this particular way, where S1 circle are put it here and rotating by S2 sphere. Well, there's a two-dimensional sphere bounded the D3 ball. Then you can find that they also detect something non-trivial about the TQFT. Okay, so these are the design for detecting this TQFT by performing certain braiding process of the anionic objects of a string of brains. The reason I say anionic is just because there's a fractional statistics. It's not just bosonic or fermionic. It can be fractional. And all right, so I think I'm out of time, so I just skip the gauge dynamics. I was trying to say that the thing is that once we determine the anomaly, view as an intermediate field theory, the strong couple theory of SU2 gauge theory, at a deep IR, the anomaly must be matched. So there are several ways to match anomaly, either by symmetry breaking or symmetry preserving gapless CFT, or by fully symmetry preserving, but there is still a Tahu anomaly must be matched by something. One thing to match the anomaly can also be a gapped TQFT. So these are further exotic scenario. Well, most of the case, people believe that time reversal will be spontaneous broken, but the CFT might be also possible, which is also exotic. But this one is even further exotic. I would just want to point out that we have a procedure to determine how the anomaly can be matched without a gapless sector by just fully gapped TQFT and without breaking any symmetry. So these are like no chiral symmetry breaking and no deconfinement, but still saturated anomaly by a TQFT with emergent gauge field. And that scenario of doing this actually is a general philosophy Edward talked about in Nati phase like 3 years ago, is that suppose we find the anomalies in certain group G, and by trying to view that there is an emergent gauge sector that you would like to gauge later as an emergent gauge theory, but enlarge to some larger group, such the anomaly become so-called trivialized, then this construction can be a very systematic way to construct the third exotic scenario. And sorry, where is it? The third exotic scenario for this case, the symmetry enriched anomalous TQFT. Okay. And indeed, yes, one-point symmetry. Yeah. So the familiar case is that the Haldane chain, for example, is the protected by SO3 or time reversal. You can try to leave the two-fold degeneracy Kremers doubly by extend to a larger SU2 or Z4T symmetry. So this means that there is some spin 1/2 additional degree of freedom U8 on the boundary, and you can leave out the zero-mode degeneracy. This means that you try to couple to some Kremers doubly on the boundary, and you can also leave the degeneracy by adding additional degree of freedom. Well, the things here in the higher symmetry cases that you just need to know what's the precise space-time and one-form symmetry, and you try to pull back to a larger group. That's actually, in this case, we need a one-form Z2 extensions, and there is a way to rewrite the phi D inverted TQFT such that you can construct a symmetric preserving TQFT without breaking time reversal and without breaking one phone, but with an emergent two-phone gauge field. And the procedure of doing this is same as what Edward talked about this 3 years ago. Okay, so let me just summarize. Actually, I also have a condensed meta realization of the Hamiltonian or Pasenko version of this bulk TQFT. So in principle, this is just a well-defined usual quantum theory that you can write on a lattice or putting on computer. And it's a generalization of a Kitai toroidal with a variable defined not just on the vertex or link, but also need to put on the parquet. And there are some constraint term like A term, B term with some commuting properties. And then similarly, once I have this bulk, I can also write a boundary TQFT, follow the procedure that I just mentioned 2 slides ago, follow Edward's talk. So then I also mentioned the dynamics, but the most exotic one I discussed mostly today, there's also 2 other cases which I skipped. And another thing is that since Yang-Mills theory is living as a boundary condition of TQFT, it might be interesting to study the boundary conditions for the theory. I I just comment this because I was given talk to mathematicians, so maybe some math people will be interested. And thank you for your attention. Right. So the reason I mentioned the trauma is that because this means that the status of thinking about something is not quite sure it's true, or is it exist, or is that still in a dreaming process. And if you listen to music, you will see some part of the music, you go to a dreaming status and become realized, and you fade away. And what's the similarity here is that some of the link invariant we determine is nearly realized, but there's a subtlety. Subtlety in the sense that some of the link invariant I compute occur in the TQ of T, because the gauge group, let's say if it's SU2, a lot of invariant, if it's a Ma2 class, some of them cannot occur. So just putting in show is that I show you a lot of link invariant also in the handout. Some of them actually is more subtle. It may not occur, although it happened in the calculations, but it may not occur just because the limitation of the gauge group. And I haven't explored the SU1 case, so I cannot fully understand whether they are true or no. But some of them are indeed realized in TQFT. All right, so thank you for your attention.